Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. We're going to go ahead and get started now. I want to welcome everyone. My name is Valerie Escalante. I'm the assistant to the Glendora City Manager. So tonight we, I believe, have a very captivating and informative presentation that will be delivered by a renowned futurist and best-selling author, Jack Uldrich. The purpose of tonight's presentation is to educate the community on the advancing innovations that are making progress every day, and we hope that the presentation causes you all to reflect on the possible changes and impacts that the changes can have on our future. While no one can predict the future, Jack will aim to help us prepare for it. Having critical foresight as to these changes will hopefully help our residents, our business owners, and our community leaders make better decisions today for a successful tomorrow. At the conclusion of the presentation, we will have a question and answer period. So if anyone has questions, we have Janet Stone, our library director, who will go ahead and bring a microphone so you can ask your question. A little bit on our speaker. Jack Uldrich is a renowned futurist, a best-selling author, and a prolific speaker on technology, change management, and leadership. He has addressed Fortune 100 corporations, venture capital firms, regional and state government entities on 5 different continents. He makes regular appearances on the Discovery and Science channels, and he is a frequent guest on major media outlets such as CNN, CNBC, and National Public Radio. He is here tonight to share his energy, his anecdotes, and thoughtful business and personal advice while entertaining, educating, and inspiring us. So please help me welcome Jack Uldrich.
Thank you, Valerie. She advanced to my first slide. So you saw the title of my presentation was The Big Aha, How to Future-Proof Your Community Against What's Coming Next. And the Big Aha is an acronym. It's how I want you to think about the future. And what the acronym stands for is Awareness, Humility, and Action. And I'm going to walk you through each one of these three principles. But before I do that, I know one of the most common questions I always get is, well, what do you do, Jack? What does a futurist do? And that's a great question, but rather than tell you, I want to show you what a futurist does. And I know that a few of you may have already seen this video, but I'm going to show it to you again anyways. What I want you to do is I want you to count the number of times the people in the white shirt pass the basketball. Whoever gets the correct answer is going to get a signed copy of my latest book. So does everyone understand what I'm asking? Okay, count the number of times people in the white shirt pass the ball. Here we go. Okay, that was it. How many people counted 15? Could I see a show of hands? So a few of you. What about 16? Any of you count 16? Okay, more of you. What about 17 or some other number? Okay, everyone who said 16, please stand up. Remain standing. Unfortunately, I don't have books for all of you, but I have a tie-breaking question, but only the people who now are standing can participate. But whoever gets the correct answer to this follow-on question gets the book. So of the people standing, who could identify all 3 changes in that video? There were 3 quite distinct changes. What about 2? Who saw 2? Who saw the most obvious of the people standing? Yes, sir. In the no, I'm looking for something else. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, it was actually a person in a gorilla suit, but I will count bear. Could I just see a show of hands how many other people saw the gorilla? Have a seat. Okay, so it looks like about 20% of you saw the gorilla, but even those of you who saw the gorilla, there are a few other things that you missed. Those of you who didn't even see the gorilla, here's everything that you missed. And this is, in fact, the exact same video.
Let's rewind and watch it again. Here comes the gorilla, and there goes a player and the curtain is changing from red to gold.
So I told you I was going to show you what a futurist does. Look, I gave all of you an incentive to focus on a very specific task. Count the basketballs and you're going to win the book. My guess is, in your day-to-day job, you're similarly focused like a laser on whatever your specific responsibility is in the community or in your job. As a futurist, I have the luxury of stepping back and looking at the big picture. And the first thing I like to remind my audience is, there is in fact the equivalent of a person, an 800-pound gorilla, walking front and center into our lives, stopping, beating its chest, saying, I'm going to transform your whole community, but a lot of us don't see it because it is in the form of new emerging technologies. And I'm going to talk about many of these technologies that are transforming our world, but a lot of us don't see it because our attention is focused elsewhere. But beyond that, in the not too distant future, as a result of technological change, certain jobs, certain industries are going to fade away. It's kind of like the person in the black shirt just walking away. It's difficult to see this transformation, but I'm here to tell you it's coming. But beyond that, customer behavior, business models, and students, their behavior is all changing. It's kind of like the curtain changing color. It's difficult to see all of this transformation, but if we want to future-proof your community, the first thing we have to do is just become aware of how much is happening right in front of our very eyes, but we're just not seeing it. But before I get into helping you understand all of the technologies, I want to help you think a little bit like a futurist. And I'm really excited that there are a number of young people here in the audience. And here's why, is that a couple of years ago I wrote a book all about helping you think like a futurist. It was called Jump the Curve. And when I was writing the book, came across a wonderful quote from Einstein. And decades ago he said to scientists, he said, if you can't explain what you're working on to a six-year-old child, you're a fraud. I thought, wow, that's a really good test. Just so happens my son Sean was only 6 years old when the book came out, and I wanted to see if he could understand what I meant by jump the curve, because I need you to understand this concept. And I didn't know how to do this, but one day my son came to me, he was very excited, and I said to him, because he'd lost his first tooth, I thought, ooh, here's the perfect opportunity to teach my son how to jump the curve. So I said to him, imagine the tooth fairy comes to you this evening, gives you two different options for your teeth. And it's a fact, all babies have 20 teeth. Option number one, tooth fairy is going to leave you a dollar per tooth. His eyes get really big. I go, that's one option. The second option is he might leave you a penny for your first tooth, two for your second, four for your third. That penny doubles 20 times. Which one do you hope he leaves? He said, well, I hope the dollar, because I want $20. I go, okay, fair enough. Do you, however, know how much your 20th tooth under the other option would have been? Sheepishly, as a six-year-old boy, he said, no. I go, well, as your father, I'm about to tell you, it would have been worth $5,242.88. To which he probably said, no way. I said, yes way. And then I said, look, son, let's plot that penny out in a graph format. Early on, the doubling looks insignificant. Two pennies, four, eight. Doesn't look like it's going anywhere. But after just 20 doublings, that curve shoots up to over $5,000. So if my son would have wanted to understand the implication of the two offers, he would have had to jump that exponential curve. That's why a six-year-old boy needs to know how to jump the curve. The reason you need to know how to jump the curve, it's because today, no fewer than 10 technological forces continue to double. It's computer processing power, it's data storage, it's bandwidth, it's the sequencing of genomes, advances in biotechnology, nanotechnology, robotics, 3D printing, sensor technology, the collection of data. All of these trends, they're not increasing linearly, they're increasing exponentially. So if we want to think about the future of this community, we all have to jump that curve, because that's where the future is going to take place. And now let me just give you a concrete example of a Californian who jumped the curve. How many of you know who this guy is? He's Reed Hastings. He's the founder of Netflix. And 20 years ago, he wanted to start a business. What he wanted to do is send cassettes through the mail. Well, that business model didn't work because video cassettes were quite heavy. But he saw data storage was doubling every 6 months, and he said, oh, by around the year 2000, we're going to be able to put movies on DVDs. And once we do that, they're going to be so light we can put them through the mail. And that's exactly what he did. And he jumped on top of that trend and created a really successful business. But then, around 2008, he looked out to the future again and he said, oh, bandwidth is doubling in capacity. DVDs are going to go away. We're going to start streaming movies. That's not so good for our business. So what do we do? If we want to survive, they've had to start doing something completely different. And how many of you have noticed over the last 4 years, what Netflix now does is they produce their own movies. They no longer send movies. I mean, they still send some through the mail, but that's not their primary business. In a world of accelerating change, you have to think about your business and your community differently. That's the opportunity. But those people who can't jump the curve, how many of you have seen something like this in your community? They saw the same trends, but for whatever reason, they couldn't bring themselves to adopt fast enough. And that's why it's so important that all of you are here today thinking about the future of Glendora. So now, let me just walk you through a number of trends that are going to double. And these are in no particular order, but the first one is wearable technology. How many of you already wear a Fitbit or a fuel band? So it looks like about 5, 10% of you. Has it ever occurred to you, well, what might the Fitbit 2.0 of the near future look like? We know it's coming. Well, here's one idea. So personally, I don't know if that's cool or creepy, but here's the transition we're living through. Many of us, I'm 52 years old. When the internet first came into popularity 20 years ago, how did we access the internet? And many of us still do, through the desktop computer. Now, of course, in the era of smartphones, we're accessing the internet through our smartphones. In the not too distant future, the internet and its information is going to come directly to us. And this is going to transform the world in some strange ways. And let me just give you a recent example. I suspect not too many of you play Pokemon Go, but how many of you are at least familiar with Pokemon Go? Yeah, most of you are. This is fascinating. It only came into existence in early July of this year, but within a week, there were already more people playing Pokemon Go than were on Twitter and Netflix combined. That's extraordinary. And you might think, oh, well, Pokemon Go, that's just a silly game. No, it's not. What it is, it's the first documented use of what people are calling augmented reality. They're layering digital information on top of the physical world. And my point is, in the not too distant future, as you walk down the streets of Glendora, you're going to start having information about businesses and traffic lights and advertisements come to you. It's going to require people to think differently. I love this sign. I mean, you've always had signs here in Glendora, but in a world of augmented reality, the information is going to come directly to the citizens. And as community leaders, you can begin presenting them information about traffic conditions, about the air condition, about water usage. You can begin figuring out how to help citizens do things differently in this future. Here's another wearable technology. How many of you know what this wearable technology is? Can I see a show of hands? So some of you do. These are virtual reality goggles, in this case. So those of you not familiar with virtual reality, you put the goggles on and it feels as though wherever the goggles are showing you to be. To give you a sense of how real this feels, this grandma is watching Jurassic Park. So she feels as though she is in a dinosaur park. All right, so apparently it feels pretty realistic. So you might think that that's just silly, but here's what you need to know about virtual reality goggles. About a year ago, Facebook bought one of the leading virtual reality goggle companies for $2 billion. Why did they do that? They didn't just do it because they see the future of entertainment and gaming, although they certainly see the applications. They see the future of retail. I do not mean to suggest that all of us are going to be doing all of our shopping in virtual reality. But what happens if even 5 or 10% of the public begins doing that? What if this young gentleman prefers to shop that way? Or what if some of people who are growing more elderly and can no longer drive to the mall as quickly prefer to shop virtually. Well, the number of retail establishments, they're not going to go to zero, but what happens if even 5 or 10% of the number of retail establishments here in Glendora disappear in the not too distant future? What's going to replace those, or what do we begin doing with the space? We have to be prepared for how fast the world can change, because it's changing before our very eyes. Here's another trend that's growing exponentially. Trend number two, how many of you are familiar with 3D printing? I see a show of hands. So most of you are. This is a physical printing out of objects. Those of you not familiar with it, here's
what. 3D printer is kind of like magic. One minute you have this box on your desk, and the next minute you see an object appearing out of thin air.
So that's pretty cool, but here's what you need to appreciate. 5 years ago, a 3D printer like that, $10,000. The one in this video is available this year for $199. And we're no longer just printing cheap plastic objects. We can now print things with 161 different materials. General Electric has said they're going to start printing aircraft engine parts by 2020, so just within the next 4 years. But it's not going to stop there. Here's what they're already doing over in the Middle East.
Dubai has opened what it said was the world's first functioning 3D printed office building, part of a drive by the Gulf's main tourism and business hub to develop technology that cuts costs and saves time.
3D printed buildings are already a reality. If this trend grows exponentially, what's the future of housing? What's the future of construction? How do we need to be thinking about all of these trends? And if you don't think this is real, Saudi Arabia has said, we in fact intend to print a million buildings within the next decade for our lower income people. The world is changing fast, and we need to be aware of these trends. But here's the opportunity, and I'm just, I don't know anything about Citrus College, and I don't know all the programs they have, but maybe one of the fields that they in the high school should be looking at is, in fact, 3D printing, because here's how some of these technologies are going to merge. Earlier I talked about virtual reality goggles, and I just talked about 3D printing. Watch how these two technologies might merge together in the very near future and transform the future of, say, shop technology classes.
And then finally, we use the Oculus Rift, which is immersive virtual reality that actually tracks your head position, and you really are moving around the object. It feels like it's right there in front of you. Now let's use this for an actual component on the rocket, which is a cryogenic valve housing. You can really apply your intuition and take something from your mind to a physical object with far greater ease than we currently do. Now that we've gotten it, the object out of our head and into the computer, how do we get it out of the computer and into reality? So we're actually going to print this with a 3D laser metal printer.
You can have an idea in your head, you can design it in virtual reality, and then print out that physical object. That's where we are today. The reason this is so exciting is I suspect that some of you are looking at some of those earlier trends and saying, oh my gosh, 3D printing is going to put construction workers out of work, and wearable technology might put other people out of work. And that is true. But what's really exciting is that many of the young people are going to be educated on these new tools, and they're going to be able to create entirely new industries and jobs. But that's only going to happen if the high schools and the community and technical colleges have these tools and are training the next generation to create the future of Glendora. But here's another way I want you to think about the future, and this goes back to this idea of exponential growth and jumping the curve. Who could tell me the mathematical relationship between these numbers? 1,000, million, billion, trillion? Yeah, each one is 1,000 times larger than the next. The reason this is so important is if something doubles 10 times, it's not 10 times as big. Through the power of exponential growth, it's 1,000. 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, 1,024. So if any technology doubles 10 times, that means a 1,000-fold increase. And if a technology today numbers in the thousands, but it's doubling, in a decade's time, we're going to be in the millions. If we're in the millions today, but it's doubling, we're going to go to the billions. Each one is a quantitative leap ahead. And I suspect that some of you are saying, we're not going to see any thousand-fold increase in anything. You know what? Before I even talk to you about the future, let's just step back 18 years. This won't work for the younger people in the audience, but I want to see if some of you older adults can recognize this sound from just 18 years ago. Any of you recognize that sound? Sounds quite antiquated today, but it was a 56K modem. All society has achieved in the last 18 years is a 1,400-fold improvement in bandwidth capacity. And we've gone from fixed landlines to today's mobile wireless world. You've all seemingly been able to navigate that 1,000-fold change fairly easily. It should open your mind to the idea that you're going to continue to live through some 1,000-fold increases. So let me just walk through some 1,000-fold increases that may be coming our way. Oh, but before I do that, just on bandwidth, we know in the next 4 years, we're going to move from 4G to 5G. And that sounds like a really nice incremental increase. It's not. 5G is 100-fold faster than 4G. And what we're going to do is this is going to transform the world in some powerful ways. Let me just give you one example in healthcare. This is North America's first virtual hospital. It's actually a real physical hospital, but they are now using 4G technology and ultimately 5G technology. What they're going to do is deliver telemedicine to 3.5 million people in rural parts of Missouri and Arkansas. So my point is, and I just picked out Foothill Presbyterian Hospital. I know there's East Valley and there's the community hospital. But my point is, you as a community have to begin understanding how these trends are going to help keep your community healthier. You're going to be able to push out preventative healthcare information to keep the community healthier. You're also going to be able to help those seniors and more elderly folks, instead of coming to the doctor's office, they'll still have to go to the doctor's office for some aspects of treatment, but some things they can be done virtually. That's how these trends are going to transform your community sooner rather than later. Here's another 1,000-fold increase coming through our way. It's advances in nanotechnology. I'm not going to bore you with the details, but nanotechnology as an industry is going to go from $100 million in revenues 5 years ago to $100 billion by 2020. So from $100 million to $100 billion, it's a 1,000-fold increase. Let me just show you some of the things that are coming our way. So Nissan already came out with a new nano-coated car. It's a self-cleaning car, so it'll never have to go to a car wash. So maybe some of the car washes on Route 66 might disappear in the not-too-distant future. But what else are we going to have? Well, down in Mexico City, they've now nano-coated a hospital, and it cleans the air. It actually takes carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and helps reduce smog in Mexico City. So maybe some of the buildings could help keep the air here in Glendora cleaner than it already is. But here's another nanomaterial that could revolutionize our world. It's called graphene, and it was discovered 10 years ago, but here's just a couple of things that we might be able to do with it within the next 2 years is this.
Like electric vehicles. Now you pull into a gas station. Well, you'd pull into a charging station, and within a minute, it would charge up your car.
Because of graphene, you might be able to recharge an electric vehicle, not in 4 to 8 hours, but in less than a minute, faster than you can refuel your existing car. I wasn't paying attention to the price of gas as I came in, but my guess is it's probably around $2.40 a gallon out here, and it might higher. I'm from the Midwest, so it's a little lower there. California is always a little more expensive. But my point is, even if gasoline stays at a relatively low price, it might not matter if you can recharge an electric vehicle really quickly. The number of electric vehicles might increase exponentially. And suddenly, what does that mean for the community? Well, as a community, you're going to have to start figuring out where to put electric recharging stations. Should they be here at the high school? Should they be down on Route 66? Where else in the community should they be? As the number of vehicles increases, it's going to put different stress on our physical infrastructure. But here's one other thing that graphene might allow us to do, is to radically lower the price of desalinization technology. I took this slide. I know down in San Diego, they just went live, I believe about a year ago, with a new massive desalinization plant that's giving them the water that they need in San Diego. But if we can lower the cost of desalinization even further, suddenly water, which is a huge issue here in California, and I suspect it is in Glendora, I don't know that for a fact, but we could go from scarcity to abundance. I don't want to say that necessarily will happen, but here's how advances in nanotechnology and material science might change our world in a better way, much faster than people appreciate. The next trend, another 1,000-fold increase, the number of robots that are being deployed in society is increasing exponentially. How many of you saw, this is just 3 weeks ago, Chipotle is now partnering with Google to deliver burritos to university students at Virginia Tech. I thought that was interesting. But here's where advances in robotics get a little more interesting. Just 4 months ago, over in Europe, for the first time ever, three trucks, self-driven autonomous robotic trucks, drove between two port cities. And there was, in fact, a human in the truck, but he didn't even have his hands on the wheel. Well, that was in April of this year. And then in May, there's a company called Auto, which Uber just bought for $30,000. They're retrofitting, they're turning existing trucks into self-driving autonomous trucks. And there still is, in fact, a human in the truck. He's just hidden behind the seat there. But my point here is that any of you know what the most common job in America is today? It's truck drivers. 3.3 million. And I don't want to say all of them are going to disappear in 10, 15 years, but these advances are happening fast, and we need to think about the societal implications of all of this. But of course, it's not going to stop there. I know that many of you are already aware of the extraordinary advances Google, Volvo, and others are making in self-driven cars. But here's how I want you to think about it. I came across this video a while back. This is someone getting into a self-driven car for the first time. I got a kick out of it, and I think you might enjoy it.
What?
It's driving itself.
So I think many of us who are older, that's exactly what we think the future is going to feel like, just downright frightening. I'd never give up control of the steering wheel. And you know, that might be right, but maybe the future is going to feel a little bit different. This clip was just caught 6 weeks ago here in California. This is in a traffic jam in California. This fellow is in a Tesla, which has the ability to drive itself. And it's a little hard to see, but the car is in fact moving, but he's asleep at the wheel in the traffic jam. My point is, maybe in the future, self-driven cars become so comfortable and so good that we feel comfortable enough to fall asleep in them, and that this future won't be as frightening as many people think it will be. Because here's what's fascinating about Tesla. Every car that is on the road, everything it learns, it shares with all 70,000 other cars on the road, and they are getting exponentially smarter. Yes, there was recently, 2 months ago, an accident in which they suffered their first human fatality, and that was a tragedy. But what people don't understand is the lessons learned from that accident were instantly shared with every other car on the road, so that accident will never happen again. And oh, by the way, 4 miles from that accident, a human driver killed 4 other people. And across the country that day, 90 people. And this year, 30,000 Americans are going to die because of human-related accidents. Is that this technology might be able to keep us all a lot safer. A couple other 1,000-fold trends. You're going to start hearing more and more about the Internet of Things, but this is the idea that we're going to go from millions of computer chips and sensors on physical objects to billions. So here's how I want you to think about this trend. I'm from Minneapolis, and some of you might remember 8 years ago we had a bridge collapse, and we rebuilt the bridge in record time, but when we rebuilt that bridge, we embedded it with 400 sensors. And so we made it a super smart bridge, and we've connected it to the Internet. So that might beg the question, if this is a super smart bridge, what's a dumb bridge? Well, here's a dumb bridge, and we have hundreds of thousands of them all across the country. But my point is, we're going to start making everything smart, including cities. This is a city over in Spain, but let me just show you a couple of things that they're already doing. They're putting sensors on every trash can. So instead of picking up trash every Wednesday, regardless of whether it is full or empty, they know exactly when that trash can is full and when it needs to be picked up. And as a result, they're saving 30% on fuel and maintenance and labor costs. Up north in San Bruno a couple of years ago, there was the tragic explosion. Had there been sensors on those pipelines, that problem could have been prevented. Over in Flint, Michigan, there's a $1 billion problem. There should have been sensors on all of those water pipes telling us that there was lead-infused water pumping into people's faucets and showers. As we can put sensors throughout our physical infrastructure, the ability for Glendora to do things better, smarter and more efficiently is going to be absolutely extraordinary. But you have to start thinking about these things sooner rather than later. And yes, it is going to be an investment, but the opportunity to save extraordinary amounts of money down the road is going to be really possible. A couple other trends that I need you to be aware of. Gene sequencing technology is doubling every 4 months. So here's how I want you to think about this. This fellow's name is Craig Venter. 10 years ago, he said, hey, I want to sequence my genome. That's exactly what he did. 10 years ago, it cost him $100 million. He was a billionaire, so he could afford it. But gene sequencing technology getting better every 4 months. So the corollary is the price is cut in half every 4 months. And if you cut $100 million in half every 4 months, starting in 2007, something remarkable happens. By the end of 2014, the price had already dropped to $10,000. By the end of 2015, it dropped to $1,000. By the end of this year, it's going to drop to $100. But hold on to your hats. By 2020, it's going to be more expensive for you to flush your toilet than it is to sequence your genes. That's extraordinary. What cost $100 million 10 years ago is going to be pennies in the future? Yes. And this is going to profoundly transform healthcare and the pharmaceutical industry. But one of the things I think society has to begin preparing for is the possibility that all of us are going to be living a lot longer than we think as a result of not just the advances in genomics, but biotechnology, nanotechnology, regenerative medicine. And I suspect that some of you are already thinking, I don't want to live to 120. And I get that, but you know what? Living to 120 in the future might not be anything like living to 120 today. Our brains are going to be sharper. Our knees are going to be more flexible. Our hips are going to be more flexible. But my point is, every community today, my guess is Glendora is prepared for 3 generations. But what happens if we go to 4-generation households or potentially even 5-generation households? This is an issue that we all need to be thinking about. And again, I don't know what the city pension rules are here in Glendora, but this idea that people are going to be living longer is going to put a lot of pressure on Social Security, Medicare, pensions, and all of our personal retirement. So all of you in the room, if you're not already prepared to live to 100, I think you're already selling yourself short. And at a minimum, you should be thinking about living to 100, because the possibility is going to be a lot better than I think most people expect. Another 1,000-fold increase, continued advances in computer processing power. So this is IBM's Watson. So 4 years ago, it was capable of 80 trillion calculations per second, truly mind-boggling. But that was 4 years ago. All Watson has done, gotten 1,000 times faster. So we've gone from trillions to quadrillions of calculations per second. And some of you might remember 4 years ago, they put this computer on the game show Jeopardy, took on the all-time human champion, crushed him. Well, that was 4 years ago. How many of you watched 60 Minutes just 3 days ago? And did you see Charlie Rose was interviewing an artificial intelligent robot? It was a little clumsy and a little awkward, but my guess is when they re-interview that robot in 4 years, it's going to be vastly, vastly smarter and more fluid and more human-like. So here's how I want you to think about artificial intelligence. Does anyone still have on their possession the iPhone 4S? Anyone have that? Yeah, there are a few of you. And it only came out 3 years ago, but the S stood for what? Can you remember? Siri. It was artificial intelligence. Suddenly you could ask your phone a question, it gave you an answer. And Siri does a pretty good job, but it still makes a few silly mistakes. Well, we have to appreciate Siri's going to get 1,000 times smarter. So what does this mean? Well, here's what it means. It means we're going to go from a world where we ask our phones questions to a world where our devices know us so well that they begin telling us things that we need to know before we even know to ask the question. And if you don't believe this, watch this. It comes from healthcare, but it points to where the future is headed.
What could this tell me about impending trouble?
Well, we're working on a project that will take a nanosensor in the bloodstream that is smaller than a grain of sand, and it will pick up a signal when you have cells that are coming off, shed from the into the bloodstream, coming off from the artery lining, which is the precursor to a heart attack. And then you will get on your phone a special heart attack ringtone.
A special heart attack ringtone. I do not know about any of you, but if I get a heart attack ringtone, I'm quite likely to have a heart attack. Or with my luck, my phone will be on silence. I won't hear it coming anyways. It'll still get me at the end of the day. But what I like about this clip is, doesn't that sound a little bit crazy, a heart attack ringtone? Well, this fellow, his name is Dr. Eric Topol. His understanding of continued advances in computer processing power, nanotechnology, artificial intelligence, tell him that idea of a heart attack ringtone, it's not way off in the far, fuzzy, distant future. It is just a couple of years away. But what I also like about this technology, he's taking all of these technologies to do what? To solve a problem for his patients before it ever becomes a problem. And that's what we all want as patients. We don't want the world's best treatment after we've had a heart attack. I mean, that's nice, but what we want is that heart attack from never happening in the first place. That's where the future is going. And I want to go back to that smart city. What the citizens of the future will want is not potholes fixed quickly. They'll want those potholes from being prevented from ever happening in the first place. And as leaders, you have to begin figuring out how to harness these technologies to solve people and citizens' problems before they ever become problems. But now let me just tell you about two other trends that are continuing to pulsate through society at an exponential pace. And this is the amount of data we are collecting is skyrocketing. And it has been for years, but we're just that little white dot in the middle of the exponential growth. We're going to experience a 1,000-fold increase. So what does this mean? Well, some of you might have seen in today's Wall Street Journal that Amazon is now getting into the grocery business. Do they really want to be in the grocery business? Well, to one extent they do. They see an opportunity to make money. But what they're really in is the data business. Every time you buy something, what you buy, when you want it delivered, how you want it delivered, they're collecting a little more data on you. And then, to collect even more data, do any of you, have any of you purchased this device? There are a few of you. It is Amazon Echo. It's an artificial intelligence platform that you put in your home or kitchen, and just with your voice you can order things through Amazon. But every time you do, it's collecting a little more data on you. And here's what Amazon really wants to do. Here's their end goal, and they said it publicly.
Anything you want on Earth, you're going to get from us.
Anything you want on Earth, you're going to get from us.
That's where we're headed, I believe.
Anything on Earth. That's a pretty big umbrella, folks. It's not just books, not just consumer items, anything on Earth. And they're now collecting so much data on their customers that their end goal is to know what you want to buy before you even know what you want to buy. And you might laugh, but over this last holiday season, they were strategically placing objects here in the Glendora area in anticipation of the idea that you or someone in your community was going to buy product X so that they could deliver it to you as quickly as possible. This is going to put pressure on a lot of grocery stores, on a lot of retail chains. They're going to have new competitors. And as communities, we have to really think long and hard about what this means for the future of a lot of businesses in our community. But all of this change requires a great deal of humility. And earlier, the title of my presentation was The Big Aha. And the H stands for humility. And I'm going to give you a demonstration of humility. This won't work for everyone, especially not the young people. But what I want you now to do is I want you to just turn to the person next to you and answer for them this very simple question. What two colors are the yield sign here in Glendora? Go tell the person next to you what two colors are the yield sign. Okay, I heard the answer. So how many people say yellow or yellow and black? Could I see a show of hands? Okay, congratulations. That was the correct answer up until 1971. The yield sign has been red and white since Richard Nixon was in the White House. I'm sure some of you are going, no way, that's not the case. Yeah, as a matter of fact, it is. The first yield sign you see after leaving the school will be red and white, and curiously enough, every other one all the way home will be. Inevitably, I know that someone was going to want to pigeonhole me after the presentation, go, well, in the rural parts or outside of Glendora, they're still yellow. No, no, they're not. They're not yellow and black anywhere in North America, and they have not been for decades. But to me, this is a great metaphor for humility, is that, look, it is a fact that years ago, many of us who are a little older, when we were first learning to drive, yield signs were yellow and black, or the textbooks were yellow and black. The problem is that old, crappy information has just stayed stuck in our head, even in the face of overwhelming visual evidence to the contrary. We've been zipping by these red and white signs for decades, and it just hasn't processed. My message to you is this. Look, there are certain things you learned about your job, your industry, your community, your business model, your competitors that, yes, they were all true yesterday. It doesn't mean that they're still true today. We all need humility to the idea that not everything that sits up here is still true. Now, those of you who said yellow and black, I'm not done with you yet. If you're a little curious as to what your brain looks like, here's what your brain kind of looks like. So it looked good back in the day. So that's a lighthearted example, but now let me just give you another more practical example. If I was here 5 years ago and said to most of you, what color is a taxi? What would most of you have said 5 years ago? Yeah, kind of like the yield sign. Well, they're yellow, right? Well, that was true 5 years ago, but is it still true today? Can I see how many of you have used Uber? Can I just see a show of hands? How many of you know what Uber is? So most people do. What's fascinating, Uber could not have existed as a company 9 years ago. Cloud, mobile, social, GPS technology all existed for 9 years ago, but they had not yet scaled and converged into a point where a company could create a platform that made it safe for strangers to take rides with strangers. And it has a $70 billion market cap. And it's decimated the taxi industry in many communities. But what else is it doing? It's changing, especially young people's behavior. Instead of purchasing an automobile, they're saying, you know what? Why spend $15,000, $20,000 on a new or used car? Why deal with insurance and parking? It's all just a hassle. I only use a car a couple of times a week, and when I do, I'm just going to access a vehicle. It's exchanging ownership for access. But that's not the only thing that we're going to Uberize. There's another company called WeWork that is saying there's a lot of underutilized office space in communities around the country, including Glendora, that are underutilized, and this company is figuring out how to help businesses and startups share space. It's really great for the startups and the entrepreneurs, but if you're in the commercial real estate business, maybe not so good. But here's how else it's going to change our world. I want you to just soak up that little factoid for a moment. How many of you own a drill? Could I just see a show? Most of us do, but unless you're a real hobbyist, the average drill is only used 13 minutes in its entire life. So the question that is now being asked, especially in urban settings, is does everyone on my city block or in my apartment building need to own a drill? No, they don't. They just need to access a drill the 13 minutes they need it, and they can get it at a fraction of the cost. But we're not just going to do it with drills, we're going to do it with lawnmowers, we're going to do it with boats, we're going to start figuring out how to share a lot of resources. And it's going to be really good for people because your bills are going to go down, but not so good for the companies who are making the drills and the lawnmowers. The world is changing. We have to be aware of it. But what else can we share? I just heard that the school next week is putting some solar cells on the school. In the not-too-distant future, maybe people in Glendora, not everyone has to have their own solar cells, but there are now solar gardens popping up in many communities around the world where people in the community just access solar energy. So maybe there are different ways to think about all of these trends. But let me just hit two more points on humility. One of the ones is those of us who are a little bit older, lots of times we're introduced to brand new technologies and we think, oh, I understand how this is going to, how to use this technology for my business or for my community. And sometimes we do, but other times we should have a little more humility. You're all going to recognize the technology in this video clip. It's a desktop computer, but let's just watch how this person used it 30 years ago. So those of you who are a little younger might not get the joke. There was once a time a thing called a manual typewriter, but here's my point. It's easy to laugh at this now, but I think a lot of us make the same mistake. We look at advances in robotics or 3D printers or virtual reality goggles, and we go, that's stupid. That's not going to affect me. You know what? Maybe you're right. But maybe, just maybe, because you didn't grow up with these technologies, you might not be the best one to understand how they're going to transform the world. And let me just go back to the virtual reality goggles. I'll be the first to admit that that looks slightly ridiculous. But here's what is not ridiculous, is that General Motors has said within the next couple of years, virtual reality is so good that many customers are comfortable test driving a new vehicle in virtual reality and buying it before ever actually setting foot in the physical car. And they hope to close 10% of their car dealerships in the not-too-distant future. I don't know how many car dealerships are here in Glendora, but in the not-too-distant future, maybe one or two will go away. Because many of us will still prefer to get into the car and test drive it ourselves. I get that. But maybe some young people will be like, nope, I'm cool just testing it in virtual reality. The world is changing really fast. And one thing all of us can do, at least those of us who are a little older, is get a reverse mentor. Hopefully you're mentoring younger people in your job and in your community. But those of us who are a little older, we have to pivot 180 degrees and get reverse mentors, people who are younger than us. Why? Because they see the world from a different perspective. And I'm going to give you a little test here as to whether you might benefit from a reverse mentor. This was on a entrance exam to a kindergarten. I did not know that kindergartens had entrance exams, but apparently some of them do. And the five-year-olds had 20 seconds to determine what parking spot number that car was in. Since you're a little older, I'm only going to give you 15 seconds, but if you know the answer, keep it to yourself, but see if you can figure out what parking spot number is that car in. Okay, who's absolutely confident of their answer? Could I just see a show of hands? Okay, someone tell me what it is. 87, that is correct. And what did it require you to do? You had to see the problem from a different perspective. And most five-year-olds get it, and they all got into kindergarten. But that's all reverse mentors do. They just see the world from a different perspective. You and I are so locked into seeing things one way, because that's how we've always seen them, that we just sometimes need to be jolted into a new way of seeing the world. So now I'm going to begin wrapping up, and I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. I'm going to see how close all of you have been paying attention. If you have arthritis of the hands, you are exempt from this exercise, but if you don't, you have to participate. So I want everyone to watch me as closely as possible and do exactly as I do. Everyone, put your hands up. Put your hands out a little bit. Now clap them together. Everyone, flip your hands over. Now take your right hand and put it over your left. Okay, everyone, this is your right hand. All right, very good. Now, if you're sufficiently flexible, lock those fingers together. Okay, they should be locked. And now lower your hands and tap those index fingers together. And now, were you all paying attention? Because if you were all paying attention, everyone in this room should be able to quickly, simply, and elegantly, and without moving your shoulders at all, rotate those fingers 180 degrees to the top like a gun. How many of you can quickly do that? I see one gentleman here in the front. but are most of you somehow suspiciously locked up? There's another. All right, have a seat. There are a few of you who got it, but my guess is most of you are locked up, and you'd have to go all the way over. All right, I'm going to show you what just happened there, and then I'm going to tell you why I do this too. So, first, here's the trick, and I know if I don't show it to you, half of you are going to be under the chair. That's like, how'd that guy do that? So here's the trick. And you can go back and do this with your family tonight. Say, watch me as closely as possible. Do exactly as I do. Put your hands up. Put your hands out. Clap them together. Flip them over. Take your right hand. Put it over your left. Everyone does that right. But you might remember I acted as though someone in the audience did it wrong. And I said, no. Your right hand. Most of you followed that hand with your eyes. As you were following that hand with your eyes, I just used the opportunity to flip my other hand that way, which allowed me to do that. But if you don't see it, you end up locked up. So, why do I show you this? Well, here's why I show it to you, is that here's the one thing I know for certain as a futurist, and it's this. It's after I leave here today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, your world is going to change again. But if you don't pick up on these changes, what's going to happen? You're going to end up locked up and behind the curve. But if you do pick up on these changes, you're going to be flexible and adaptable enough to steer yourself, your business, and your community into the future. So all of this is a long lead into the final A, and that's action. And here's the action I need everyone to take. It's to regularly take time to think about the future. I, in fact, advocate taking a week to think about the future. And can I already hear what some of you are thinking? You're thinking, who do you think you are to tell me I have to take a week to think? Don't you understand how busy I am? I do understand how busy you are. But if you're saying you don't have a week to think about the future in a world that's changing as fast as ours, you're saying you don't have 2% of your time to think about the future. If you're not thinking about your future, the future of your family, the future of your business, and the future of your community, who exactly is? And I get that a week is a lot. And if that's too much, break it down into smaller increments. Take an hour a day or an hour a week, 12 minutes a day. I don't care how you do it, but regularly step away from your regular news sources to read, think, and reflect on how the world is changing. And let me just give you some things I think you should be thinking about. I talked about the self-driven cars. How many of you know just 12 or a month ago in Pittsburgh, any of you see this news? Uber now has self-driving taxis in Pittsburgh. It's not off in the future. It's happening today. But how many of you know what Beverly Hills has planned in the future? Their city council is already saying, you know what, the future of transportation, at least in Beverly Hills, isn't light rail. It's not buses. We think it's going to be a fleet of autonomous vehicles. I don't know if they're right or wrong, but they're at least thinking about the future. And could Glendora be doing the same thing? How do we solve that last mile challenge? How do we get people from communities like this to where other jobs are, or vice versa? There might be some, we need to think about how fast the world is changing. I love this book. It's not one of my books, but it's a great book. But it's called Think Twice. But what other two words are embedded in the words Think Twice? Can you see that? Thin ice. I think a lot of us are on thinner ice than we really appreciate. The world is changing really fast. And I haven't even talked about the extraordinary advances in online education. But it is no mystery that college tuition has continued to go up over the last 40 years, and it is becoming increasingly difficult for students to leave college without being substantially in debt. And online education is getting really good, and it is really affordable. And this is going to put pressure on a lot of universities and colleges. And I'm not making any aspersion on Azusa. I don't know anything about Azusa. But the number of universities and colleges that could go away in the future is a possibility. And again, I'm not saying that every university is going to go, but there are a lot that are going to be under continued pressure, and we need to be thinking about that. But as we're doing all this thinking, we have to be prepared to think different. I was talking to Valerie, and you were telling me about the facility, the Sports Authority, that there are 35,000 square feet here in the Glendora. It sounds like you now have some potential tenants for it, but there's this huge other trend that's just starting that I think is really exciting. This is North America's first urban farm, and it just went live in New Jersey, of all places. And they can produce fresh organic produce using 95% less water and 50% fewer agricultural inputs. So instead of bringing produce into communities on trucks, what companies and businesses are trying to do is to figure out how to grow fresh produce to where the people actually live. And so is it possible that some of the existing strip malls and other offices could be retrofitted into urban farms? From my perspective, it's a possibility, and someone should be thinking about that. But after we do all of this thinking, we have to think bold. This is North America's first truly net zero energy building, meaning it's completely off the grid, using nothing but solar cells, wind turbines, other things, completely off the grid. And that's really exciting. But Burlington, Vermont is now America's first community 100% on renewable energy. Is it possible in 5 or 10, 15 years that Glendora could be entirely powered by renewable energy? I think it's possible, and someone should be thinking about this. What are the opportunities for our community? But as we do all this thinking, we have to think even bigger. And I'm going to begin ending on this note. So what I want everyone to do is I want everyone to think of a pond the size of this room. Okay, and let's say for the sake of argument, it is the first day in November. Okay, and there's a tiny little lily pad on November 1st, and it's perfectly sized so that if it doubles every day in November, so on the 2nd there would be 2, on November 3rd we'd go to the 4, the next day we'd go to 8, then 16, 32, 64, you get the idea. Keeps on doubling on the last day of November, the whole pond is covered with these tiny little lily pads. Can everyone picture that exponential growth? So here's the question. On day 20, so two-thirds of the way through the doubling, what percentage of the pond would be covered? And I'm going to give the book to whoever gets the answer within 1%. So just shout out some guesses. What are some guesses? 2%? No. 18? No. 100? No. 12? No. 60? No. Whoever said 2 was quite close. I'm just going to... Nope. Yeah, who said 1? I'm going to give you... Do you know the more mathematically precise answer? Does anyone know the mathematically precise answer? The answer is 0.1%. And I'm sure most of you are going, what do you mean? For the last hour, you've been telling me how fast all of these technologies have been doubling. And you said the lily pad was doubling, but it only covers 0.1%, 1%? Yes. This is exactly what I'm trying to tell you. Because what else did I say? If something doubles 10 times, it could be 10 additional times, but that's what happens from day 20 to day 30. How much bigger does something get if it doubles 10 more times? 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, do you remember? 1,000, it gets 1,000 times bigger. Then here's what happens. By day 25, a little over 3%. By day 29, we get to 50, but once we get to 50, the very next day, boom, the whole thing is covered. Why do I show you this? Well, I suspect that some of you are saying, well, Mr. Future Man, if the world's changing as fast as you say it is, how come my world and the world of Glendora feels pretty much the same? My message to you is all of these trends have, in fact, been doubling. What you need to appreciate, we're just at day 20. The really big change is just ahead of us. This is the change we need to be aware of. This amount of change requires humility, and it demands action. And again, I just want to say how happy I am to see young people here, because this is the future they're going to be living in, and we need to begin preparing them for this future. But for those of you who are a little bit older, I want to give you hope and optimism that you're going to be able to handle it as well. And do you know why I'm so confident? Because you've already done it. And I'm going to prove it to you again. I gave you that earlier example of the modem, but let me give you another example. How many of you can remember the hit movie from the late 80s, Wall Street? Any of you remember that? Michael Douglas plays Gordon Gekko. He's this high-powered titan of finance on Wall Street. But to show he is a super wealthy person, can you remember what technology they showed him using in the movie? Can any of you remember that? Yeah, it was that big brick-like monstrosity. That was the Motorola Dynatech 8000X. And for those of you younger kids in the audience, that cost $5,000, and it only made telephone calls. That's all it did. But to help you understand how strange the future may be, sometimes it just helps to step back and appreciate how odd things are today. And I came across this photo a while back, but it is a homeless fellow now using a smartphone to accept digital donations. So my point here is not to poke fun at the homeless. It is to remind us that technology has this curious way of getting better, faster, more affordable, and as it does, it explodes out like that lily pad and transforms the world. I want you to think of all the advances I told you about, the 3D printers, the robotics, the Internet of Things, the genomics. We're all just at this clunky cell phone stage. Each and every one of these technologies is only going to get better. Let me just go back to this lily pad example. How many of you know what Airbnb is? So most of you, this is strangers staying with strangers, kind of like Uber couldn't exist. But here, this is just the city of Paris. So 5 years ago, 25,000 strangers stayed with strangers. But here's what happened over the last couple of years. The next year went to close to 100,000. The year after that, 250,000. The year after that, it went to 500,000. We don't have figures for 2016, but it was close to 1 million people. This is putting a lot of pressure on the hotel industry, but it's also bringing a lot of income into thousands of citizens who are allowing strangers to stay in their homes, and they're making an additional source of income. But what else could grow like that lily pad? I talked about the number of electric vehicles. By 2020, we might go to 17 million. And then 5 years after that, 500 million worldwide. And the number of autonomous vehicles, I talked about Pittsburgh last month. Here's what they have planned over in Gothenburg, Sweden, next year.
Of course, we have the objective in 2017 to actually bring 100 self-driving cars to our customers on real roads here in Gothenburg.
So 10 in Pittsburgh this year, 100 in Gothenburg next year. It doesn't look like it's going anywhere until suddenly we experience a 1,000-fold increase in autonomous vehicles are even here in Glendora. I don't want to say, again, that will necessarily happen, but we have to be prepared for a world that could change faster than we can appreciate. So what's next? Well, as a futurist, I don't claim to know what's next. But I'm going to end on this note. It comes from Peter Drucker. He was a great business writer. He said, the only way to predict the future is to create it yourself. The one thing I know is all these tools, technologies, and trends are real. But the future of Glendora is going to be created in your hands. Those of you with the courage and the wisdom to take these tools and technologies and to think differently about serving the citizens are going to be those who position this community for great future success. So with that, I really appreciate the opportunity to be here, and I really look forward to entertaining your questions. So thank you, and I believe we have, is it Janet?
Yep.
Janet is going to pass around the microphone for